not one to break promises. I don't want to hurt you, but I need to breathe. At the end of it all, you're still my best friend. But there's something inside that I need to release. Which way is right? Which way is wrong? How do I say that I need to move on? You know we're heading separate ways. And it feels like I am just too close to love you. There's nothing I can really say. I can't lie no more, I can't hide no more. Got to be true to myself. And it feels like I am just too close to love you. So I'll be on my way.
My great-grandmother was in the band, the Black Kettle, when they were attacked. There was one little child that was walking up the creek bed, and there was a soldier there that was using the little boy to start at practice. He took one shot, aimed, missed him. A second came along, tried and missed him, and a third said, "Let me kill the little devil." The little boy dropped dead. You had pregnant women that were, whose bodies were being cut off, cut open, and the fetus is being taken from them. The private body parts of men and women were cut from them, and some of them used as saddle horns, hat bands, tobacco pouches, and put on public display in Denver City, in such a way that you would begin to ask, who is Savage in this case? Certainly it's not the Cheyenne.
For a council held at Camp Weld, Shivington, a former minister, was the military commander in Colorado Territory and nominal head of the 3rd Colorado Regiment, formed exclusively to hunt down Indians. At the meeting, Black Kettle said, "All we ask is that we may have peace with the whites. You are our father. We've been traveling through a cloud. The sky has been dark ever since the war began." In return, Evans accused the Cheyenne of initiating hostilities and said, "The time when you can make war best is in the summertime. When I can make war best is in the winter. You, so far, have had the advantage. My time is just coming." At the end of the conference, Shivington stated, "My rule of fighting white men or Indians is to fight them until they lay down their arms and submit to military authority. They're a nearer Major Wynkoop than anyone else, and they can go to him when they get ready to do that." Ironically, both sides wanted peace, and yet the conference ended without any firm commitment to peace from either side. Indian historian D. Brown wrote that Black Kettle took Shivington's remarks to mean that Black Kettle's people would be safe if he brought them to Fort Lyon on the Arkansas River. However, other historians dispute this claim, pointing out that when the Indians went back to Fort Lyon, they stopped at the cattle ranch owned by John Prowers and told him, They could not make any treaty of peace with them, meaning Evans and Shivington. On November 9, 1864, Black Kettle and the Cheyenne began arriving at Fort Lyon. By this time, Wynkoop had been relieved of his command for being too soft on Indians, such as giving them food and supplies against orders. The new commander, Major Scott Anthony, directed Black Kettle and his band to camp 40 miles to the northeast on the Big Sandy, also known as Sand Creek. Meanwhile, Shivington had other plans.
Colonel Shivington, who had been at the Camp Weld Council in Denver in September 64, learned at that meeting that the Indians that he had been hunting for and hoping to kill for several years were probably camped at the Fort Lyon area or on the Big Sandy Creek nearby. In mid-November, he left Denver with his troops, headed downriver down the Arkansas to Fort Lyon, which he reached on the night of November 28th.
On November 28th, now in command of 700 troops armed with short-barreled carbines and pistols, and with four 12-pound mountain howitzers, Shivington ordered his cavalry to march to Black Kettle's encampment.
There were probably 115, 120 teepees here, with maybe 500 men, women, and children. Shivington approached from the south, approached the village. Some of the Indians actually went out to meet him. As a matter of fact, some of the first casualties of the fight here were two Colorado troopers who were shot down off of their horses. There was no mass charge through this village. Shivington had dismounted his men, and they actually walked through the village, allowing the Indians to escape up creek and a little bit more to the north, northwest up the creek. The soldiers walked through the village. When they got to the far end, they saw the Indians fleeing, and it was at that time that many of the officers lost control of their men. And the men, almost on an individual basis, started going after the fleeing Indians. They chased them up creek for several miles. As they ran, the Indians dug in at points all along the creek bed, dug themselves homemade rifle pits to make little defensive positions. The soldiers chased them throughout the rest of the day on the 29th. The battle lasted from dawn up until about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So it was quite a long, drawn-out affair. There were quite a few casualties, more than we would think of. The soldiers took 76 casualties. That was about 25 killed and 51 wounded, which may not sound like a lot, but in the context of the Indian Wars, that was a heck of a fight. That was put Sand Creek up at the top of all the fights in the Indian Wars as per casualties. As for the Indians, that was pretty devastating to them also. They lost probably upwards of 150 killed. The things that distinguished Sand Creek here was afterwards, after the battle, the atrocities. Some of the men again lost control. They no doubt were angry. They had known what had happened through the rest of the summer with the Indian raiding, the massacre of the Hungate family in June outside of Denver, and the soldiers were taking vengeance. They had scalped and mutilated a lot of the Cheyenne bodies after the fight. No doubt they saw this as a just vengeance and a great victory. For the Cheyennes, of course, they view the event as a massacre.
Miraculously, Black Kettle survived, even while returning to save his wounded wife. However, Shivington's massacre at Sand Creek elevated the Cheyenne military societies, particularly the Dog Soldiers, into power. Americans back east were horrified by the Sand Creek massacre. Lincoln removed Governor Evans, and 2 months after Sand Creek, Shivington was out of the service. Black Kettle's peace attempts had failed, and now the Cheyenne, Arapaho, and Sioux, enraged by Sand Creek, chose to make war to the knife. The massacres in Minnesota and Sand Creek inflamed passions on both sides. And for the next 26 years, there'd be a battle to the death for the Great Plains.
Unit assembly.
Major.
You better come take a look at this.
Asks for a council. I bear witness to his fair treatment.
I've been traveling under a cloud. The skies have been dark ever since the war came. We want to take good tidings home to our people. I want all the chiefs of the soldiers to understand that we are for peace. That we may not be mistaken by them for the enemy.
Governor Evans and Colonel Shivington have heard your words. The governor and the father of all white men in this territory will now speak to you.
We cannot live together on this land. War among the whites is nearly through. The Great Father will have nothing to do with his soldiers except send them out after the Indians. Your people must make their peace with us.
I have done my best to keep my young men quiet, but they do not always listen.
And by their rebellion, they seek to help the gray coat traitors who make war on us.
No. We do not fight the white man's war.
All Cheyenne have ears open. White Antelope proud to see all white chiefs of this country. Since I go to Washington and received this medal, I have been proud to call all white men brothers.
Whatever peace you make must be with the soldiers, not with me.
Is she? No.
I am not a great war chief. But in this country, all the soldiers are under my command. My rule of fighting, whether it's the gray coats from the south or the Indians, is to fight them until they lay down all their arms and submit to military authority. When you are ready to do that, then Major Wynkoop at Fort Lyon will see to all your needs.
Please, everybody, look this way. Lichet Kia.
That's no captive. She's one of them. Black Kettle, it is an honor for me to present to you the flag of the United States.
Everyone, very still.
With all due respect, gentlemen, Cheyenne don't want a war. I believe their pledge is to be sincere.
And what will I do with the 3rd Colorado Volunteers if we make peace?
The 3rd was raised primarily to kill Indians.
Then they must kill Indians.
The tall chief said, as long as this flag flies above our camp, no soldiers will harm us.
Margaret Lightshines had lifted the people's spirits with the magic of the white man's shadow box. Now Black Kettle called on the young men who remained behind to search for the buffalo.
These men are fed, given a place to rest. We march on the hostiles at Sand Creek tonight.
I've heard of no new provocation, sir.
Don't you know the Cheyenne Nation is guilty of robbery, arson, murder, rape, and fiendish torture? Not even sparing women and children, I feel it is right and honorable to use any means under God's heaven to end these outrages.
Including murder, Colonel?
Better without him.
No! Remember the Hun gates!
You look back on the plains of the Platte where your mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters have been slain, their blood saturating the sands. Take no prisoners. Kill them all. Scalp them all.
That's right. Every last one.
As quickly as you can. Soldiers will save.
Turn to your people. Tell them a great shame fills my heart.
You are my people now.
See how these savages treat their prisoners, Major?
Damn you to hell, Colonel. You wanted war, now you're gonna have it.
And welcome to the American Experience. I'm David McCullough. It happened on June 25, 1876, in central Montana, by a river called the Little Bighorn. Five troops of the 7th U.S. Cavalry, including their flamboyant commander, George Armstrong Custer, were wiped out by an overwhelming force of Sioux and Cheyenne warriors. By the standards of modern warfare, it wasn't much. Yet the Custer Massacre has been the subject of more popular interest, more myth-making, than almost any event in our history. Nor is the fascination an American phenomenon only. Every summer in Montana, thousands of foreign tourists descend on the battlefield. Tonight's film is an attempt to sort out what happened by drawing on accounts from both sides. Last Stand at Little Bighorn is the work of producer Paul Steckler and of writer James Welch, who is a Native American. For a long time, it was commonly said that there were no survivors of the Custer Battle, an observation that in itself indicates how very one-sided were most versions of the story. There were, of course, hundreds of survivors, Sioux and Cheyenne, and the renditions of combat you'll see here were all drawn 100 years ago by just such veterans, recording what happened as they remembered it.
June 26, 1876, Lieutenant James H. Bradley, 7th Infantry, Scout Patrol. We entered a valley cut by a dry creek, and here came upon the fresh tracks of ponies. We had seen a heavy smoke rising in our front, apparently 15 or 20 miles away. While speculating upon the circumstance, three men were discovered on the opposite side of the Bighorn. Apparently watching our movements, some of the Crow scouts whom I had furnished to General Custer. We at once signaled to them. They responded that Custer had followed the Indian trail and yesterday struck the village on the Little Bighorn, the Sioux warriors letting him get close to the village and then sallying forth in overwhelming numbers to meet him. The corpses of Custer's men were strewn all over the country. It was a terrible, terrible story. So different from the outcome we had hoped for.
263 United States soldiers died at the Battle of the Little Bighorn in 1876. Mostly farm boys and immigrants, far from their homes, they served a nation determined to take these western plains. Generations of Americans remembered them as heroes, part of a legend called Custer's Last Stand. News of the disaster soon broke across the country. Overnight, newspapers transformed the utter defeat into a vision of heroic martyrdom. Reporters who had never been within 1,000 miles of the Little Bighorn wrote of Custer making his gallant last stand. They singled out Sitting Bull as the fiendish agent of Custer's destruction, writing that he had learned Napoleonic war strategy from French Jesuits, or was not even an Indian, but a white renegade once expelled from West Point. A cry arose to avenge America's fallen hero. The Chicago Tribune wrote, "It is time to quit this Sunday school policy and exterminate every Indian who will not remain upon a reservation." The Army mobilized its entire Western force against the Sioux and Cheyenne. Their rallying cry was, "Get the first scalp for Custer." Throughout the fall and winter, the Army pursued the scattered bands, marching in sub-zero weather. The troops burned villages and supplies. The bands fled before them into the snows.
Before they left to go up in the hills, they saw the destruction of the camp. They saw the teepees go up in flames, and they heard the horses as their throats were cut. Well, all of the gathering of the summer's food had just, they had just lost it. And there they were up in the mountains with nothing to eat. And most of their warm equipment was left in the camp, and it went up in flames.
The Army chased Sitting Bull's people north, keeping them from joining Crazy Horse. Crazy Horse's wife was sick with tuberculosis. His people were hungry and desperate.
Dukteil, Uyampikich, wherever we went, they came to kill us. Crazy Horse hardly ever stayed in camp. People would find him out alone in the cold. Once my father found him out alone like that, and he said to my father, "Out here, the spirits may help me. I am making plans for the good of the people." Black Elk.
One by one, the bands began to surrender.
Years had passed since Robert and Clara had left Pennsylvania. Robert had seen the land's promise turn bitter, but he was determined to carry on the best way he knew how.
Yeah, the feral scaffolds are outlawed now. A lot of things have changed since they split up the reservation last year. And now you got pockets of white settlers all over.
I imagine it's so different.
10 years is a long time, George. Oh! Oh! Stand aside, please.
You give something.
These rations are property of the U.S. government. I'm just the man who delivers them.
Government had no stomach.
You're gonna have to get your rations from Agent Royer.
Royer?
I'm sorry for your plight,
but there's nothing I can do. Now, please, stand aside.
When your children cry for food, you will do nothing?
Your rations or not. Pay attention. Next.
No distribution till the line is straight. Can't you people understand what straight means?
You're the reporters. Tell me.
Looks like he's got nothing for us, as usual.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint your ears.
You'd think, with all the hauling you do between here and Standing Rock, you'd see at least one young buck on the warpath.
You know, you boys could stand to get out of the agency for a spell. Why don't you talk to George? He just arrived here on the overnight out of New York City. I'm sure he'd be happy to share his impressions.
Next.
Royer around? You know he never showed his face on issue day.
Next.
Only coffee, flour, and blanket this month.
No meat?
No meat, no sugar. Flour, coffee, blanket. Next.
I want bacon. Children very sick. We need food.
Bacon is meat. Next.
Ingrates.
You holding back on us here, Wheeler?
Well, I want to talk to Royer. A little business matter.
Next.
No long hair. No more than one wife. No heathenish ways, no old religion, no drinking, no language but English. If you can accept these things and step over there and pick up your uniforms.
Indian police are doing well.
Well, can't blame him for wanting something better, I suppose. Things took a bad turn back in 88. Crops failed, 2 years running. And the Indians weren't the only ones who suffered. We were damn near wiped out. But Clara, the boy, and me, we saw ourselves through. She can't wait to see you.
To see a world in a grain of sand, and heaven in a wild flower. Hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. Isn't that a wonderful thought? To see see a world in a grain of sand. How many times do we look without seeing? Poetry teaches us to see things in a different way. And there's no reason to be afraid of it. Let's try. Read among yourselves, quietly. What a dapper Eastern gentleman you've become.
It's good to see you, Miss Clara.
Don't be so formal. It's just plain Clara now.
Yes, ma'am. I believe I'll let you two get reacquainted. I've got some business with Royer.
Come, my pupils. Class, I want you to meet George Voices That Carry. George was a student of mine a long time ago. He used to live here in Pine Ridge. Now he's come back, I hope, to teach.
No, not to teach. To learn. I lived among the white men for many years. But I am still Lakota, like you. And there is much to learn from our people.
Congress sets the policy, Mr. Wheeler. I am merely charged with carrying out its intent. The beef allotment to this agency has been reduced by 1 million pounds. Washington takes its census numbers quite seriously.
Well, it seems pretty damn short-sighted if you ask me.
And what about this bill of lading?
Couldn't bring myself to refuse them. They were starving. I'll pay for the lost goods in full.
Your charity only exacerbates a difficult situation, Mr. Wheeler. You may want to have a look at this. My colleague at Standing Rock, Mr. McLaughlin, informs me that rumors of an Indian Messiah are spreading like wildfire. He reassures me it is only a minor annoyance, but I have my doubts.
Well, no telling where desperate people will find hope.
I can only do so much, Mr. Wheeler. More than that, I am not allowed.
These people are suspicious of any changes. Your predecessor, Colonel Gallagher, was a hard man, but fair. They'd come to respect him.
Be that as it may, the new administration has selected me to see to its affairs.
Well, maybe when you've been here a little longer.
As you say. Is there anything else you wish to discuss?
No. No, I figure we're through.
I'll say good day, then.
Let's go, people. Keep it moving.
Waniki iki, te pachuta ki, washa kilo, akotaha, otatita kuye, wawicha glakapelo.
Wachipiki lehlila, wawoshi chinktelo.
Waniki yaki wa situo, we chonki zapikta kea hoa.
Hia, ie handuki, washichuki, iayapi ketelo.
Wachipiki o yateki, unspe wachaki ya piktelo.
Wawoka chiapiki, tawoi hamlaki. Wawicha yalahuo.
A perfect key. What we chow a lie alone.
Could stop this nonsense with a word, but the old codger says it's nothing to do with him.
As I understand the dogma, sir, it shares many of our own Christian principles. A harmless version of their outlawed sun dance.
Looks more like a war dance to me. And you, Mr. Wheeler, you consider this demonstration harmless? Thank you to stay out of government business, Mr. Wheeler. This obscene display will cease immediately.
This prayer, white people pray, go heaven. We go heaven too.
You will stop dancing and disperse.
Kosh, Kalaka Lakota, Koichape, Echiape, Kata Taka.
We're gonna get out of my way.
Down, Mr. Duffy.
Make it fast, Lang.
To the editor, New York Herald. The long-awaited violence here finally exploded today when a band of armed hostiles confronted the government's agent. Against impossible odds, Agent Royer acquitted himself without bloodshed and brought a well-deserved end to the pagan spectacle known as the Ghost Dance. It is common knowledge in these parts that the Sioux never dances foul dance except for one purpose, and that is war.
What happened?
Sheriff, my child.
Tell me what happened.
They came for my father-in-law. They came to arrest Sitting Bull. They came to take him away. We tried to stop them.
Where are you taking him?
Father, don't let them take you without a fight.
Be quiet. They won't go. They won't go. Stand back. Stand back, or we will arrest you all.
I got it.
The horse. The white horse. It danced. We all turned to look at him. And he fired. They killed him. They killed Sitting Bull.
No!
They shot Groven. He's just a boy. They killed him too.
Tried to take our weapons. You had more than this. You had Winchesters and Henrys. I know you had Winchesters and Henrys. Where are your weapons? He shouted.
Search the teepees.
Have heart, men. This is Zaya's promise. Will come true. Bullets will not harm you. Their bullets will not harm you.
Search all of them. They tried to take a gun from a deaf man. He couldn't hear and they didn't care.
Leave him alone. I can't hear you.
Bye.
Sing it, y'all. So what? You had a bad day, and things may have not went your way. Damn, what a tragedy.
R.I.P. NYC, 911, real tragedy.
Now we live in a time where greed runs out, and it's hard trying to survive, but we won't get down because we've got these
rough times. Nobody has left on their minds.
Time to steady changing
everything. Seems so much easier.
Yet so much harder in these working times. Gotta get that
cheddar, man. I know you know better, man.
Gotta take some.